The following program may contain adult language and mature subject matter and does not necessarily reflect the views and opinions of Reality Radio 101, its advertisers and sponsors, or its listening audience. Listener discretion is advised.
Heading up 35, one way we're headed at 90K. Over the two-lane causeway, we'll go left, it's gonna be a classy day. Kickstands down, head on over to the band stage. Kick back and listen to the band play. Whoa, whoa, let's take a ride today.
Good evening and welcome to This House of Musicians with your host, singer, songwriter, and founder of the band Inner City Outlaws, the baritone bear, Mr. Barry Smith, right here on Reality Radio 101. To get on board, send us an email right now. Our email address is thishouseofmusicians@gmail.com.
Whoa, whoa, take a ride today.
And now, right to your host of This House of Musicians, Mr. Barry Smith.
Hi, folks. Welcome to This House of Musicians radio show. We hope you enjoy the next hour with us as we do our small part to help promote musicians, bands, and venues. Gary, how are you?
I'm fine, thank you. It sounded like World War III going on there.
Oh, I don't know what's going on here. I think everything's good at this end. I'm stoked tonight, Gary, to have Miles Goodwin from April Wine on the show. I've been listening to Miles for, 40 years or more. Just an incredible songwriter. Everybody, he doesn't need any promotion. Everybody knows who he is. So let's introduce him right away. How you doing, Miles?
I'm fine, thank you.
Good. Glad to hear it. We're glad that you're here and on the show. It's definitely an honor to have you. Let's start right at the beginning, Miles, if you don't mind. I know you were born in New Brunswick and you grew up in Nova Scotia, correct?
Yes, that's right. Yes.
And when did you first get introduced to music? Like, how did you know that that's something that you wanted to do?
Well, my mother's side of the family was musical. I heard music, you know, around the house just as a kid. Radio mainly, right? The radio seemed to be on most of the time. And so whatever they were listening to, I was hearing.
Mm-hmm. And who did you, who were you influenced by growing up?
Well, a lot of it was country music. That's what my dad was into. But I did, I'm old enough to say that I saw Elvis Presley on Ed Sullivan in 1956. Mm-hmm. I saw the Beatles also on Ed Sullivan, their debut in America in 1963 or 4, whatever it was. I just listened to what was on the radio. And back then, there was a lot of country, like I said, but even the top 100 Billboard, if you will, or Cashbox, was a real plethora or mix of different styles. You'd have country and movie themes and joke records and serious records. I mean, it was just everything. It wasn't broken down into different genres and there weren't a lot of stations. So everybody, you know, whoever was, you know, about was playing everything that was out there, really.
Sure. And how'd you get your first guitar and learn how to play guitar?
Dad got me a guitar. I don't know how old I was. I'd say somewhere in the neighborhood of 12 or something, 12, 13, I guess, something like that. An acoustic guitar, not electric, but he bought me a Norma, Japanese cover of a Gibson Hummingbird, I guess. And I still have it, as a matter of fact. I've managed to carry that through life, and thanks to a little help. But anyway, that was my first guitar, yeah.
That's amazing. And when you were a teenager, you wrote Just Between Me and You. How impressive is that? How did that come to be?
I wrote Just Between You and Me, not Me and You.
Sorry.
Yeah, it was just an observation, basically inspired by being on stage and watching the girls that I was interested in dancing with other guys, you know, because I was on stage. So I'd see them leave with whoever while I packed up, you know, and that kind of inspired it, you know. It's not necessarily one person that refused to dance with me. It was just inspired by that whole situation, you know. So
absolutely,
it's very youthful. Of course, songwriting is often just about the imagination. Just not that everything that you write is truth, you know, a fact. It's just a lot of it can be, and it can be all kinds of things, as I'm sure you know.
Yeah, absolutely. Sometimes it's about, you know, like things that happen to you in your life, and sometimes the songs just come out of nowhere. Were you in a band? Now, let's talk about April Wine. What an impressive band. My goodness gracious. Did you have a band before April Wine, or is that what you started right out with?
Well, professionally, I had one band before that, I had high school bands, you know, that's where I wrote and played You Won't Dance With Me. In a high school band, but after all my learning, the first professional band was a group that I joined in 68, called a band called Eastgate Sanctuary. We're just a cover band, and we were in Cape Breton, and that was I was only in the band a year at best, and then I down the driveway, we had a farmhouse, and down the driveway one day came this fella that I knew and asked me if I wanted to join a band with him. The fellow's name was Jim Hedman, him and his cousins, so that was the invitation to join this group that became April Wine in 69.
Absolutely amazing, and what a career. How did you come up with the name?
I didn't. David Henman, who was the guitar player in the original band. The original band had three Henmans. It was David Henman and Richie Henman. They were brothers. David played guitar and Richie was the drummer. Jim Henman was my friend and neighbor since 1963. Went to school together, and we, you know, grew up together from 63 on, really. And so David came up with the name. He just came up with the name. Apparently the thinking then was that, you know, a name that doesn't mean anything. It just, where some bands, like Black Sabbath or Led Zeppelin, you know, you're talking about a hard band, but for some reason he chose those words, and, you know, I didn't like it then. I've learned to like it. I mean, it's what you make of something, but that's what it is. I mean, it did cause a bit of confusion.
So 16 studio albums, that's pretty impressive. Let's talk about the very first album, Miles. Where was it recorded, and how long did it take you to do it?
It was recorded at RCA Studios in Montreal. I don't remember how long it took to record it. I don't remember very much about it at all. The fellow that produced it was a fellow named Bill Hill, and it was for Aquarius Records, that we were signed with Aquarius Records. Actually, I think the very first record came on another label they were affiliated with somehow. I forget now. But I did speak to Bill Hill a while ago because my memory of the first recording is Jim Hedman, who was there. We don't have a lot of recall on exactly any of the details, oddly enough. I remember the tape op, Gatin, and I remember, I can vaguely remember the studio, but not much more than that. You know, and I spoke to Bill recently saying, I'd like you to talk to you about what you remember. And he said, for starters, I remember all of it, but for starters, it was, you know, whose guitar you used on Fast Train. And I said, no clue. He said, well, that was my Gibson, blah, blah, blah. And I said, well, that's the kind of stuff I want to know, because I'd like to tell folks about that someday. But not today, obviously.
No, that's amazing. Well,
I don't know yet.
It was definitely a long, long time ago, that's for sure.
It was, yeah, a very, very long time ago, yeah.
you've had an amazing career for sure. So what is your, let's just ask, what is your creative writing process? Like, how do you go about writing a song? Do you use a guitar? Do you just write words down and then, you know, come back to it later, or do you use riffs on a guitar and then put words to it, or?
Well, yeah. I mean, I've done it all ways, but usually it has to do with music first, and often a catchphrase. Like if I have a song title in mind, like I say, "Just Between You and Me." If I say, "Now there's a phrase," "Enough is enough," that's a phrase. "Say Hello," that's a phrase. If you pick phrases that are common, mm-hmm. I'm giving you an example here. Then I would sit down with, okay, "Say Hello." You know, what can I do with that? "Just Between You and Me," what can I do with that? Find a melody, find some chords. So that's one way. I mean, "Just Between You and Me" came very, very quickly. They came together. It was just playing, and I sang the phrase with the melody, and I said, "That's good. That's a good title. That's a good phrase. People know that phrase, and let's follow that, and let's finish that off." And I did. It came very quickly. So it works all different kinds of ways. "Say Hello" was written based on a drum beat that I was a drummer in a band for a short time way before April Wine, and I have I have drums around the house and the studio and stuff, and I like to play drums, and so I write with beats in mind too. So "Say Hello" was a very, very unusual beat, which I wrote on a drum set, and then I took it to the band, and I said to the drummer at the time was Jerry Mercer. And I said, "Jerry, can you play this?" So I showed him a part, and he played that. And I said, "Because I think I got a song." And then everything followed. So it depends.
Yep. It's usually different at times. What is your, I'm just going to ask you this now. What is your all-time favorite song to play, do you think?
Well, to play, I'm glad you said that because I was just thinking, people ask me all the time, what's your favorite song? And of course, you know, you want to give them an answer that makes a little bit of sense, because as I've been in the studio lately recording an album, a solo album, and one of the songs, it's a very adult theme. It's about songs that, well, the earliest song in this record is 38 years old. And all kinds of things that went right for April Wine. Of course, then I did the blues thing, and it's not blues. So it's a brand new thing that I'm doing, and it's got a title, blah, 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 and all kinds of great songs, I think. And one of them, one fellow said to me, he said, "That's a very beautiful song." And I go, "Well, thank you." And I said, "It's funny because people say, what's your favorite song?" And I want to say, "You haven't heard it yet." That sounds so facetious, so I would say, but you did say fun to play. So let me say Roller. Roller is a lot of fun.
Power energy, yeah, powerhouse, that song for sure. Yeah, let's talk about Roller for a bit, because we want to go ahead and play that song for the listeners. It was written by you, recorded by it was recorded in 78 off your album First Glance. The song peaked at number 24 on RPM 100 singles chart in Canada and number 34 on the Billboard Hot 100 in the United States, and that was your first American hit since 1972, correct?
Yes.
Yeah, what a great song. How'd you come up with Roller, I have to ask you?
Well, the inspiration was a trip to Las Vegas. My very first trip to Las Vegas inspired the lyrics, the idea of a lady that has an addiction, I guess, if you will, to gambling, And I honestly, I know that the lick came first. Came first. And it kind of went from there. And then I found the words Roller, and I said, well, Roller could be about gambling. And I'd just been down to Vegas within the 12 months, less than 12 months earlier. And I said, well, I'll make it about gambling, about a lady that loves to gamble. And that was it. The interesting thing for me about that song is that we had the habit of, like a lot of people, recording people, as you write the song and you discover it in the studio. And sometimes you get it right the first time, but then when you live with a song, you record, you release your album, you're out there playing this song, and you change it a little bit here, change a little bit there. All these things could have been done beforehand if you'd taken it on the road first. if you know what I mean.
Get to know it,
and then record it. Now, we don't normally do that, but on Roller we did. On Roller, I took it out on the road. I said, I don't know why, but let's do it live. And I found that the more I simplified the song, the better it became. So there's a lot of pedaling for folks out there that might know what I'm talking about musically. It's in the key of E. So we just, that low E just goes on and on, sets this kind of a beat. And we break away from that pattern only for emphasis. And so, yeah, it just kind of maintains a lot of that tonic E note. And before we took it on the road, we would have recorded it with a whole lot more changes, and the song became much, much better by getting to know it and arranging it, so it had more power. It was more interesting. Yeah.
Absolutely. And like I say, it's a powerhouse of a rock song, that's for sure. Miles, we have an email from Jane D, and Jane says, hello, I've been a huge fan of Miles and April Wine for years. I live in Queens, New York, and I'm just wondering if Miles could please tell us a little bit about his Telepol guitar. How did it come about? Thank you, Jane. Thank you for the email, Jane.
Yes, thank you. The Telepol is a guitar that was built for me by a company called Strings and Things in Memphis, Tennessee. They no longer exist. They're now called Delta Blues. But way back in 1980, in 1981, actually, I got mine made. I was in Memphis, invited to go by their factory, which was just in a mall. It was a small thing, and everything was laid out on tables pretty much. You know, it was like really just three or four guys and this dream. And they said, you want to try guitars? And I really liked the look of it because it had the body of a Les Paul that's smaller. And so I picked the body finish that I wanted. I chose the pickups, the hardware and everything, and the configuration of two pickups with the tone and the treble. And anyway, that guitar was one of a handful that were made for other artists at that very time. Now, I'm not kidding you when I tell you, I've got the flyer in my hands right now because I'm in my office, it's on my desk, and I was looking at it a little while ago, and I'm looking at the brochure, and I can actually see my guitar in here. And what happened, let me just read what it says in the back very, very quickly. Here's some of the other people that were playing the guitar at this time. This is their one and only, this is the original flyer, two-page color, beautiful. It says on the back, satisfied customer owners are Jeff Beck, Albert King, Glenn Fry, Paul Stanley, Eric Clapton, Miles Goodwin. And many,
that's
many,
amazing.
And many more. Yeah. And they had on the original guitar, like the one I still have it. It has a Fender Tele neck. So you got a Fender Tele neck on a Gibson shaped body, only smaller. And so it looks like a Les Paul and a Telecaster. So I call it a Telepol.
Cool.
The Strings and Things had another name for it, probably. I mean, if I look, maybe I'll see what it is. But anyway, I think it's a Bluesmaster. They call it a Bluesmaster, I think. So anyway, that's the Telepol. And within less than a year, probably 6 months or something like that, Fender saw this guitar because when Eric Clapton's playing it, people see it, right? And Jeff Beck. And so, I even think Billy Gibbons had one, honestly. I don't see it on here, but I think I read that too. And anyway, they found out about it within the year, and they stopped them from using the Tele neck. They built another neck, and they had the second neck for a very, very short time. I happened to buy one on eBay. It was in California or somewhere. I bought that years ago, and I made a clone of my Telepol. But anyway, and then they changed the name to Delta Blues and designed a new neck yet again. So the original guitar like mine, those models, and they didn't have a lot to choose from. They didn't look like Strats. They all kind of looked like what I've described already. Those guitars are very, very rare. They were only made exactly like mine for about a year. And I love my guitar. It's a great guitar. I've used it in April Wine so long, and, And
well, Miles, that's an amazing, a nice repertoire of definitely people to promote that guitar. You're on that list. That's amazing. And so you're going to continue to use the Tele Paul, I guess, on future recordings and that as well?
Oh, yeah, I will use it. I have certain guitars that always end up on a record, you know, since I've owned them. You know, I've got I got my Melody Maker, which I bought originally in 1968 down in Cape Breton. I have almost like 100 guitars. So, but there are a group of them that always end up, since I've owned them, on my records, whether it's blues or whatever I happen to be doing, April Wine or whatever.
Sure, I've seen a picture of all your guitars, or a lot of them anyway, and that's very definitely an impressive collection. They're all top line guitars, so that's so good for you. Now, Miles, what I want to do now, my friend, is go ahead and play an April Wine song. It's Roller. Again, it's off the album First Glance from 1978. And geez, what a high powerhouse rock song. So Miles, if you just want to bear with us, we'll play the song. We'll do a couple of ad shout out for the sponsors, and we'll come right back and talk about Roller a little bit more if you like.
Okay.
Thank you, folks. Believe it or not, I'm stoked to have Miles Goodwin from April Wine on the show here tonight. What a legend, great songwriter, great singer, everybody. You can't drive down the road for less than 20 minutes without listening or hearing an April Wine song on the radio. What a great Canadian band that they became and are. And so, folks, let's listen to Roller off of the album again, First Glance. You are listening to Miles Goodwin on this House of Musicians on Reality Radio 101.
Yeah.
welcome back, folks. We have the legendary Miles Goodwin on the show tonight. We just played the song Roller. I bet you played that song a few times, eh, Miles?
Yeah, for sure. People like to hear that. I wrote that when I write songs, I sometimes think about how to start a show, like with a new tour, something new for the folks, and an ending song. I write songs like Anything You Want, You Got It, because I needed an opener, the way it starts with digga 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 on the guitar. Mm-hmm. He builds in, and Roller has the bye 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 byes at the end as a closer. So, but I played it many times, yeah.
Oh, for sure. Now, in 2010, you guys were inducted into the Canadian Music Hall of Fame.
Yeah.
How was that? Like, you know, you had to go to a ceremony and all that. I bet you that was exciting. Well deserved.
Well, I won't argue the fact that it was well deserved. I mean, they waited, 30 years to present us with a Juno. But anyway, whatever it was. You know, to be quite honest with you, it was fantastic to get the award and all of that. And I'm really happy. I think, and honestly, most, you know, for family and myself, of course, but for the fans. The fans supported us since the first record. The fans believed in us and supported us and for so many years. And we would be nominated for Junos so many and never, ever win. And when we were finally acknowledged by Karis and given this the Hall of Fame, it was kind of like validation that they, you know, they haven't supported a band that sucked all those years, you know. It's just, you know, whatever political reason, some people... it's hard to be acknowledged by the powers that be in certain areas of Canada. I don't want to get into the politics, but you know what's bittersweet about it, and I wrote about this in my book, Just Between You and Me, is that this was the year that Bieber was huge. What's his name? Justin Bieber. Yeah, Justin Bieber. And I had never heard of the name until that night, and we had he was in the building, and that's what that night was about. Everything else was secondary. And we went out to meet the press with our Juno, and there was about five or six people in the audience that held, you know, a lot. Nobody was there. Nobody cared that we had the media didn't care that we had worked so many decades for this, and it was an honor and so forth. It was all about Justin Bieber. And that's when I kind of said, who? And they said, well, this kid. And I go, oh, well, because I said something stupid, like, you know, what's a Bieber? Who's a Bieber? What? But there were a couple of people in the audience, and I could describe them, everything else, but I won't. I think I did in my book. But she and her young son, the son must have been in his early teens, and she was there. And she went through the press, and she felt what was going on, and she was wonderful. And so when she fed me a question, I talked. You know what I mean? Sure. I said, with three or four questions, I said everything I wanted to say on behalf of the fans and the band. Yeah, unfortunately, all the band members couldn't be there, and you know, for good reason, because there have been a lot of changes in the band, and it was difficult working with the people that televised this, because from the time your foot hits that first step, the time they want your butt off that stage is about 3 minutes or something. It's so fast, and not necessarily everybody, but for April Wine, I had barely enough time to thank people, and I was getting the signal, get off stage. And so it was bittersweet, you know. I appreciate the award, and I'm proud of it, and everybody that participated in that being possible, I thank them. And I'm happy for them, but when they said, no, you can only have two people on that stage from the band, I couldn't even have four. I couldn't have five, like the heyday with Jerry Mercer, but Gary Moffat, Steve Lang, you know, Brian Greenway. No, two. And the only other person in the band at that time from that list was Brian. So Brian and I were the two people that accepted on behalf of everybody in the band, from Jimmy Hammond, David Hammond, Richard Hammond, to everybody. And that's the way it was, you know. Mm.
Well, yep. The important thing is, Miles, the fans care. I mean, you have 20.
That's right.
Over 20 million recordings worldwide. I mean, wow.
Yeah, that really is the bottom line, and it's always the bottom line. It's always the bottom line. When people are nominated, you know, it's great to be nominated, but really, it's great to win, but just to be nominated and then to get an award as well is just wonderful for the fans as well as the artists.
Absolutely. Good for you. We have another email, Miles. This is, hello all, this is from Bob V. Hello all, Miles, do you keep in touch with any of the past members of April Wine? I know that a lot of bands change members due to different reasons, and the friendships sometimes go astray, but is there anyone that you still keep in touch with?
Well, Jim Henman, the original member of April Wine, is my buddy, and I mean, I talked to him today. I mean, we go fishing together. We play music together. I have a three-piece trio called acoustic trio called Just Between You and Me Live, and Jim Henman plays guitar and sings, and a fellow named Bruce Dixon, who's also in my blues band, he plays bass and he sings. And the three of us, it's just the thing is about mostly about April Wine and the songs, and we play a lot of hits, and I talk about them. I talk about the songs in detail, and this is what we do. So you know, the last thing we did before COVID, we had a week down in Florida. We were down through Texas for a week, and we were in Arizona for a week, and we were sitting in Mesa, Arizona, having breakfast flying home before we flew home, the three of us, and there was talk about this COVID. And coronavirus, I had no idea how to spell it, didn't know much about it. And I just said, you know what, don't worry about it. It's just one of those things. The media's having a field day, we're having a lot of fun with it. But my goodness, a week later, it hit home. I mean, our musicians, man, our lighting people, sound people, all those people were unemployed. You know, we're unemployed. So, yeah, it's quite something what we're going through. And the entertainment business, movies and music and all this, everything is just... Taking a beating right now, anyway.
It sure is. Let's hope it ends quickly.
And of course, Brian Greenway came in the band in 1977, and he's still in the band. So, you know, lots of having to do with him. The other fellow's not so much. Unfortunately, very sadly, Steve Lang died not that long ago, a year ago or so ago. It was just, you know, one of those horrible things that happens to nice people. A disease that took his life, and it's terrible. He was smart, funny, a great mind, a great personality, a great bass player, and everything, and we lost him far too soon. And then Jim Clench, who was in, joined the band in 73, I think it was 73, Jim came, 72 or 73, and he sang Ooh What a Night, he wrote it, sang Ooh What a Night, which everybody knows, and he sang Weeping Widow. And so he passed away now. I'm not sure exactly. I don't remember exactly, but it's been about five or maybe 6 years now since Jim passed away. But the other fellows, every now and then Mercer will show up. Jerry Mercer, drummer, will show up at a show. And the last few times he played a song with us. But Jerry, you know, Jerry's older, 10 years older than I am. So, you know, he's more retired than anything.
sure.
Yeah, incredible drummer.
Absolutely. Just let me read you a compliment email here from Kyle B. Kyle says, Miles is one of the most talented and influential artists of the 80s and 90s music scene. With hit after hit after hit, all of his music is amazing, well-written, and so beautiful, which, Miles, I agree with you. May our Lord give Miles many more years to write and create phenomenal music. From Kyle in Detroit, Michigan.
Oh, that's nice. Well, Kyle, you take care of yourself down there, and I know there's a lot of, you guys are going through an awful lot down there with the COVID is enough, with the politics and everything else that's going on. All the best.
Perfect. Here's one from Sue P. Hello, you talk about a writer with meaning and lyrics, such, what a talent. What does, how does he do it? Personal experiences, a whim on the beach, what? Every song this guy has written is amazing words and music. Nothing bad in the eyes of fans. Thank you for the entertainment. That's from Sue. Thank you for the email, Sue.
Yeah, thank you.
Miles, let's talk about now. I know you have two very impressive blues albums, and these songs are from you know, beforehand, maybe when you were recording with April Wine, you had these songs that you tucked away and now decided to make them into, I think you have Friends of the Blues 1 and Friends of the Blues 2. And we're going to go ahead and play one of the songs off Friends of the Blues 1. But let's talk about how that all morphed, how you morphed into doing some blues stuff.
Well, I didn't write all these songs. I mean, I wrote these songs over a very long period of time. So like in 2007, I almost died. I was in hospital, three hospitals, and much rehab, and I had from internal bleeding and so forth, and which followed with my immune system. I became a diabetic within weeks of that. It was a very difficult time. I went through a divorce. It was pure hell. Everything's okay now, but it was really tough. And when I fought through all of that and survived those things, as we have to do, I realized how short life is and how, you know, all of those things. You realize your own mortality very quickly when you have something like that happen to you and or those things. And I decided that I have to do some of these other things that I wanted to do. And I've been tethered to April Wine all of my adult life. And it was time to stretch. I have much more in me than what I was giving, if you don't mind me saying that. You know, there was more to it than, you know, four guys, you know, two guitars, bass, and drums. I had more to say. So I started writing songs and preparing for an eventual blues album. I didn't have them already in April 1. I just said one day, I said, no, I got to do this, 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 and this. And one of the things that I wanted to do was to write a book. I wanted people to know about April Wine and me. And so I wrote my memoir and called Just Between You and Me. And it was very well received. It was a bestseller on the Globe and Mail. Bestsellerist. Mm-hmm. And it just told the story, the truth. I mean, I've been hearing stories about April Wine and me for decades, and a lot of it was nonsense. And so I know that, but I never spoke up. I never said anything. I'm one of those guys that'll always just, I'd rather not talk about it, or, you know, it's like musical differences, you know, but the truth had to be told, because I just felt at that point I wanted my family to know. And I wanted the fans to know. So I wrote the book, and I did very well. And I was very fortunate to have Brian Greenway collaborate everything. So it wasn't my word against everybody else's. Brian was right there, and he contributed with quotes and stuff, because I said, Brian, I need you to back me up. When people say, oh, that's nonsense, you're able to say, well, they know what Miles is saying is true. So I had validations not only from him, but from other people. And a lot of April Wine fans didn't like what I had to say, you know, from time to time, and called me awful things. But, you know, what I said was the truth. And if you don't like it, then I'm sorry. It's not going to keep me awake, keep me from sleeping. So anyway, did that. And then I started writing blues songs. I said, I want to do this. And I did. I wrote these songs, and I recorded a blues album. It was nominated for a Juno. It won East Coast Music Awards. It's an international hit. I mean, geez, it was amazing. Excuse me. And that went very well. I wrote a second book, which was well received, called Elvis and Tiger, which is fiction. I still continue to play with April Wine. I wrote another blues album, because Miles Goodwin, Friends of the Blues, which is, again, you know, was very, very successful. I won the East Coast Music Award for 2020 Blues Album of the Year, and getting international play. I mean, when I say international, I mean international. The album's been on American charts for as long as it's been out, blues charts. So not all the charts, but some of the blues rock charts is my niche, if you want to call it what I do, blues rock. So, yeah, so anyway, I got to do those things. I wanted to do them. I don't know when life's going to end for me, and I have too much inside me to be just doing one thing and sing and roll or yet again and not sing beyond that. So now I got to do everything. I got to do them, and, you know, until, you know, the last 6 months ago, when it all came to a halt in terms of live. But no, I'm in the middle of three albums right now. I've got three albums. I'm writing Blues 3, and I'm starting to decide. I decided with all the time on my hands, we're going to do an April Wine album. So I'm writing for a brand new April Wine album, which I'm excited, because I haven't written for April Wine in a long, long time. So it's fresh and inspirational. And if you don't have inspiration, it's the one ingredient in the recipe you must have. You must be inspired. And if you're not inspired, it's going to suck, almost certainly. And I'm inspired. And I haven't been inspired to write for April Wine in decades. So I am inspired now, and I'm having a lot of fun with it. And hopefully we'll get to do this record, and people will like it.
I'm sure all the fans are hoping for the same thing. I know I am, and I'm hoping to get an autograph book too from you, because I would purchase an autograph book. That'd be amazing. Just got another email, Miles. Paul S. Hello, just tuned in. I love April Wine and Miles. Does Miles still collect cars? If so, what is his favorite in his collection?
I try very hard not to collect anymore. I think I've had my share. My favorite, I have two favorites right now in my cars that I try and drive fairly often when the weather's nice here in Canada. One is my 66 Corvette coupe, and that brings me a lot of joy. I remember them when they came out. I never thought that, you know, that I would own one. It's a amazing shape. It's beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. It looks like a new car, and I really enjoy it. And also I have an NSX, which is a wonderful car made by Acura. I don't know if your fans know about an NSX, but it's a very, very cool car. Those are my two favorites.
Perfect. Well, we touched on
And my 1987 Chrysler, we call it the Blues Bomb. It looks like it belongs to a funeral home or something, but the Blues Bomb, 87 Chrysler.
I've had the exact same car, Miles. Gold.
Mine's the Fifth Avenue.
Dark blue.
Lots of chrome in the velour seats. Wonderful. Makes driving so fun.
Comfortable to drive, my friend.
They really are. Yeah.
Hey, we talked about that you've done some blues stuff. Of course, you got two wonderful blues albums. Let's go ahead and play a song. I hate to see you go, but I love to watch you walk away. This is off of Friends of the Blues 1. And then we'll come back and talk about I hate to see you go, but I love to watch you walk away, folks.
Okay.
I have Miles Goodwin on the show, and now we're going to listen to one of the songs that he wrote, a blues song, and off of his blues album, Friends of the Blues. And you're listening to This House of Musicians radio show right here on Reality Radio 101.
That you could stay. I hate to see you go, but I love to watch you walk away. Honey, 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 really like to take you home. Oh, honey, 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 I'd really like to take you home. Oh, yeah. I hope that you don't mind, but I just gotta say, I hate to see you go, but I love to watch you walk away. You walk away.
welcome back, folks. We have Miles Goodwin on the show. We just listened to Hate to See You Go. Miles, let's touch on that for a bit. How did that come to be?
Well, it's just one of those phrases, like just between you and me, and say hello, and enough is enough, like I was saying before. And I like the line, I hate to see you go, but I love to watch you walk away. I like the humor in that. And it reminded me, I'm aging myself, of course, always when I open my mouth, but there was a song way back when that's sitting on the corner watching all the girls go by. It was a big, big hit way back in, I don't know when, 40s or 50s, I don't know. And I just had a visual that went with it. And then I said, you know, I'm going to write a song with that lyric idea in mind. And that's what I did.
Absolutely. Miles, yeah. There's a segment I like to do on the show called, Well, Gary, What Do You Think?
Well, do you really want to know?
How impressive is this?
Well, here's the deal. Okay, Miles, I know you've heard it all before. You've had such a career, many decades. I'm only a few years younger than you. And I've had some success with my band in the past. In the 80s, I was signed to Atlantic Records as well. And I have a current project that's out, and we're doing well worldwide. But here's why I want to tell you that. 90% of the interviews we're doing right now, when people say, who are your influences? What do you write like? What's some of your favorite bands? Number one all the time. April Wine and Miles. I always say that in an interview, and I've been saying that for months. So my point is, you and I come from a different breed for one reason only. That's when we knew what music was to write. We used real instruments. We played our guitars. We played our keyboards. We came up with power chording, good lyrics, good harmonies, good melodies. And nowadays, a lot of musicians out there, and I'm sure Barry can agree to this, everything is technology with them. They put themselves in a bedroom with a laptop, and they think they're going to be the next April Wine. It's not going to happen. So I just want to say again, thank you for the influence. Thank you for the years of enjoyment. I remember being, when I first heard Roller, I was 22 or 23 years old, and I said, holy crap. And that was down in New York where I lived, was born and bred, and I heard that song down there, and I said, this band out of Canada is amazing. So I just wanted to thank you, Miles.
All right. Well, thank you very much. Very nice of you to say all that. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Yeah, what an impressive career. We have another email from Yola B. Hello. Now, I know we already touched on the fact that what song you like to play on stage, but I think she's asking, what is Miles' favorite April Wine song and why? Thank you. I have purchased every project that the band has put out during the years. What amazing music. So what is your favorite April Wine song? Maybe not to play, but just maybe even just to listen to.
You know, I've been asked this song for years, and it gets harder because more songs are added, you know, and I'm not going to say they're all my children. I love them all the same. I'm not going there. It's really, what is my favorite? I don't know. There's an album that we did in 1975, or came out in 75, called Stand Back. And that's my favorite album by April Wine. Now, a lot of people might say, you know, The Nature of the Beast or First Glance, and I like them very much too. But there was something about that album, that Stand Back, is the first album that we did as a band. It wasn't a collection of singles. It was the first album I ever produced, because I was tired of doing 2.5 minute songs with that whole format that went with trying to get a hit single. And I love the songs. And I love the innocence of all the songs coming to the band. And there were so many fun songs on that album for me, and the memories of that Victim of Your Love, for example. Mm-hmm. And you know, I have a lot of favorite songs from that record, to be honest.
Good. And I'm going to continue to read. We have so many emails. We're not going to get them all in. This one's from Denise. Just 6 words for you. This guy's a musical genius. That's all. Now, here's an interesting one. Let me see if I can bring it up here. Oh, my God, my crush on this man. I have a question that may seem silly, but here it goes. I've always loved Miles' curly locks. May I ask if those are real or a perm? I'm always jealous of his hair. Thank you, Rhonda.
Well, you wouldn't be jealous of my hair now, because I don't have an awful lot. But yeah, no, I never curl my hair. Real men don't do that, do they? I mean, I never did.
Of course not.
I never did.
Here's one from Ari C. Hey, I just tuned in. Any plans for Miles to tour the States after this COVID crap? Would love to see him again. I live in Aurora, Illinois.
Well, you know, we before this crap hit, April Wine does shows every year down in the States. We had a matter of fact, we had a lot of shows booked for this summer. And I know the whole season kicked off with a bunch of U.S. dates, but they're gone. We're trying to reschedule them like everybody else. I honestly would like to come back and play for folks down there again, as with the other guys of the band. But, you know, when? I don't know. I don't know. You know, right now it's not anytime soon. I think probably realistically, and I don't, you know, this is just me saying, because this devastated the world, really. I don't think we're looking at anything until 2022.
I would agree.
I don't think so.
It's going to be a while, but you do have plans to tour when it's all done.
Well, if we can, you know, I mean, hopefully it won't take as long as that, or, you know, it'll be when it happens, we'll have to decide, you know. I'm not a young man anymore, and that's what I don't like about the timing of this. I mean, I hate everything about it. There's never a right timing for something like a pandemic, but, you know, when everything's okay, assuming it will be okay and international travel is safe again, I hope I have the health and the desire to do it. The only way I can express myself now is in recording. And that's what my focus is now, is on recording new music. So if I do nothing else, I have a phrase for it. I've said it in my book and I've said it in interviews before, but I call, when we're in the studio, I call that whole process making history. And when we're ready to take roll or take one, I said, everybody ready to make history? And they go, yep. So that's what I will continue to do as long as I can.
Absolutely. Miles, we're out of time, man. Yeah. What an honor to have you on the show. You know, a long lasting, songwriting that you can still hear every day. I think 10,000 years from now, people are going to still hear April Wine. So, what a great career. Congratulations to you and all the wonderful music you've made. And it's been an honor to have you on our show. We're going to follow your progress. We're going to continue to promote all the projects that you do. And I personally thank you for coming on the show.
Okay, well, you guys take care of yourselves too. I think we all just have to be kind. We have to be, we have to stay healthy. So when this is over, we're still around to enjoy things again, life again to its fullest. Right?
Absolutely. Yeah. Agree. I'm sorry I couldn't get it. Thank you for being here. I couldn't get all the emails in. So to the listeners, I apologize for that. And also to the listener, I say thank you for being here. Dance and sing, and let the music bring your soul to the surface for all the world to see. Until next time, have a shuffle your feet kind of week, and good night. You've been listening to This House of Musicians on Reality Radio 101.